I'm here to introduce the speaker today, and I thought it was interesting to see the subject about transportation affordability because, you know, we started the general plan process, and we're always looking for new research avenues in transportation, and, of course, one of them that's coming up a lot in the literature is transportation affordability, that coupled with housing affordability for a total, basic economic equation for families. It's getting difficult for people to afford their transportation costs and live a decent life, you know, especially if they live farther out in the suburbs. But this transportation affordability is also interesting because it can relate to our transportation modeling, so it can help us in that area. We want to know why people, where they go, why they're leaving their house, where they're going, when they return, and how much they can afford to spend. It sort of relates to that, whether someone owns a car or not, you know, is directly related to their affordability. So I won't delay this any longer. Our speaker today is Noreen Beatley from the Manhattan Strategy Group. She's the project director for HUD Housing and Transportation Affordability Initiative, and she's put a presentation together to explain sustainable community items such as affordable housing, economic development, workforce development, and green building. She has 15 years of experience, or 15-year experience in this area, and without any further ado, I'll turn over to Noreen. She can explain Noreen, and she can explain why she's here. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So first off, thank you all for having me here this morning, and thanks to Kip for helping me get here as well. As Dan said, I'm Noreen Beatley. I'm Manhattan Strategy Group's project director for the HUD Housing and Affordability Initiative. MSG is a small consulting firm in D.C. that we work on performance measures and evaluations, that type of thing. We're working on this project with the Center for Neighborhood Technology. Some of you may be familiar with their H plus T Affordability Index. And the tools that I'm going to be telling you about a little bit more or later in this presentation are based on, in large part, on their tools. So what are we going to try to cover today? Basically, we're going to talk about why we need to think about housing and transportation together when we're making decisions, when we're planning, that type of thing. Basically, as Dan mentioned, a lot of people are having a harder time with their transportation costs. A lot of low-income people especially drive till they qualify. Everybody's heard that expression. The problem is as people drive further and further out to find that affordable house, they often don't think about the transportation costs that are involved in that drive. And so one of the goals here is to look at how do the transportation costs impact our household budgets, and how can we start thinking about them together and making planning decisions with them together. And HUD's particularly interested in this topic. So HUD and DOT, many of you are familiar with the Sustainable Communities Partnership. Well, in this case, it's HUD and DOT have come together, and they're trying to figure out how these two obvious expenditures work together. And so HUD and DOT are working together on the Affordability Initiative. Through it, we have produced and are still producing a Location Affordability Index and a My Transportation Cost Calculator. I'll tell you a little bit more about those. And then I'm going to try to focus on a couple of applications. So CNT developed their H plus T index about 10 years ago, and it's been applied in a lot of communities across the country. So normally I would have one of my colleagues from CNT with me. I don't today, but I have a lot of the applications that we're aware of that the H plus T has been used for. And so we're going to talk about that as kind of the proxy for how the Location Affordability Index that HUD is developing can be used in your community. So some of you may have seen this chart before. It's a chart from the Consumer Expenditures Survey. And basically, when you look at it, you recognize immediately that housing, which we often know is our largest expenditure, is pretty broad. But the second highest expenditure is transportation. And the thing about this is that even though these two costs vary year by year depending upon the economy, they're always the two largest costs. And so while a lot of people really do think about housing being their highest cost, again, as I said, they don't think about transportation. And so right now, when you actually combine and you roll up, the average American household is spending more than 52 cents out of every dollar earned on housing and transportation together. That doesn't leave a whole lot for food, childcare, healthcare, education, any other thing. So we need to figure out how can we reduce that cost or actually build it in so that, we think about it a little bit more. And beyond the cost of gas, which we know has gone up and down a whole lot over the years, there are a lot of other things that people aren't thinking about. You know, when we see the fluctuating gas costs, that's the first time that people start thinking about transportation and what it's costing them to get around. But that's not the only cost, and so we need to think about that. So let's start with what drives housing costs. You know, we always think about the old mantra, location, location, location. And we think about the amenities that are related to your house. You know, do you have a yard? Do you have the kitchen you want? Do you have the number of bathrooms, the family room, number of bedrooms? We tend to not think about the needs that we need to associate with our housing. You know, how close is it to your job? How close is it to your doctor? How easy is it to get to grocery stores, to other services? And one of the things that drives housing costs is the fact that we're not thinking about that, or housing transportation costs together. So what this project really is about is location efficiency and affordability, and trying to figure out how do we help people either live closer to employment hubs, or if they don't want to understand what the costs are involved in it. And we are looking at how the built environment really plays a role in how these costs hit us. And so, of course, these pictures show you kind of a different types of areas that people live in, from a very, very dense area, you come wrap around like clockwise, to a very kind of country, more rural area. The thing to remember about this, and a lot of you have probably seen this kind of a chart before, is what the housing cost burden is. And households in different income groups really are impacted by their housing costs dramatically differently. We say that housing's affordable if it's no more than 30% of your gross income. But if you look at this, you realize that the only people who can actually generally afford that are people who earn $30,000 to $40,000 or more. Anybody less than that is spending a whole lot more on their housing, which means that they have less money for other things. The difference is that we also don't have that same kind of standard for transportation. We have it for housing. We use it for mortgage. We use it for all kinds of different things. But we don't have any kind of a standard for transportation. So when we look at transportation costs, while we know that housing costs are fairly transparent, you know, it's our mortgage. It's our rent. We don't think about our transportation costs in the same way because they're not bundled in one thing. They're not, you pay for your gas, but you don't think, well, how much did I pay in registration this year? How much have I paid in parking? How much have I paid in tolls? What did I pay in maintenance? So those numbers have not been taken together. And so that's what we're trying to look at. And the thing is that transportation costs, just like housing costs, vary depending upon where you are, where your housing is. So these pictures give you a sense of if you're going to live in a more rural or suburban area, you're going to end up dealing with higher commutes, long congestion, that type of thing. If you live in a more dense area with access to transit, you've got more transit options. And as you have more transit options, your costs for transportation also decline. So what drives transportation costs, though? So we talk about, you know, this is a chart that CNT has put together. And for most households, transportation is really determined by how many cars they own and how much they drive them. So they use this chart. This is in St. Louis. And it's two communities in St. Louis. And you can see that a community in a more dense area, East Isles, actually pays a substantial amount less monthly in transportation than the St. Francis community, which is farther out, does. And you can even see in here what the minimum costs are and the maximum. And that's more than twice as much in housing costs and auto costs. Auto ownership within a community also is a telling story about how much transportation and how much transportation costs are. And as the density increases, the number of cars needed in a community decreases because there are other transportation options. Again, looking at these communities in St. Louis, you see that in East Isles, it's 1.3. Obviously, nobody owns 1.3 cars. But because it's a typical regional household number, it's got to be averaged out, so that's what. But you look at this, and this obviously shows that some people in East Isles probably don't own a car if it's 1.3. Whereas if you live in St. Francis, you probably can't get away without at least one car, and most people probably have two. And again, you look at this, the minimum number, obviously less than one car in some parts of the community, definitely more than two cars in other communities. And then the final piece of the transportation puzzle is, what's your vehicle mile traveled? How much are you having to travel based on where you live? Again, looking at this community that CNT did a study on, basically, it's almost twice as many miles per year if you live farther outside of the core area. And if you look at this here, you see a minimum. It's almost three times as much. The difference is that great for people who live in an urban core. Not necessarily an urban core, but a core area that's close to jobs, access, and services. And that's actually a really important distinction, is that it doesn't have to be an urban core. You don't have to live in D.C., but you do have to live in an area that's got the transportation, has transportation options, transit options, has the services you're looking for, is located close to jobs. So while we think about housing cost burden, we don't necessarily, as I said, think about our cost burden for transportation. But like housing costs, it's the people at the lowest income level that are generally hit the hardest with your transportation costs. Now, years ago, the average household spent about 8% on transportation, but over the years, that's gone up dramatically. You saw from the previous chart, now it's about 18-19%. Some low-income households pay anywhere from 23-27% for their transportation, which means there's just not a whole lot left. So, and it's also hard to track them. When you're not thinking about your parking, your tolls, your registration, all these other things that go into owning a car, it's very difficult to track how those costs impact you. So the Center for Neighborhood Technology and the Center for Housing Policy worked together on a report called A Heavy Load. And in fact, the Center for Housing Policy just released an update on that, I think last week, basically looking at commuting, looking at the cost of housing and transportation. If you haven't seen it, I would suggest you check it. They looked at, I think, 44 metropolitan areas. They looked at both rent and ownership. But one of the things that they determined is that the cost of commuting. And basically how it works is that anywhere between 10 to 12 miles away from, not, again, an urban core, but a job hubs or an employment hub, the farther you move out, your housing costs go down, but your transportation costs go up. And the breaking point is about 10 to 12 miles. The interesting thing about this two things. One is that as your housing costs go down and your transportation costs go up after about 12 miles, they basically kind of wipe out. The transportation costs start wiping out any benefit that you have from moving that far out. So basically, it kind of wipes out the benefit of the drive till you qualify. But there's another thing that's kind of interesting. So there are a lot of reports have been done looking at housing and transportation together now. The Center for Housing Policy has a lot of really great information. Brookings has done some really good reports looking at the economic development benefits looking at housing and transportation together and its impact on economic development. The interesting thing that recently that also has been looked at is how it impacts our health. So what I found out is that the American Public Health Association did a report and found this measure of where the breaking is for the housing and transportation is about the same thing for commuting and your health. If you commute more than 10 miles from your job, your health tends to decline. And I thought that was kind of an amazing way. So because I gave you the chart looking at housing and transportation separately, I wanted to give you a chart that actually put them together to let you see, you look at the lowest income level, by the time they've spent money on housing and transportation, they really have very little left. Now, some of these guys might be getting some subsidies, mostly on housing, but it still means that their budgets are really stretched thin, and that's problematic. So HUD and DOT have come together and said, we really need to get a handle on this. So there are a couple of different elements within the affordability initiative that I want to tell you about. As I said, it's a joint effort between HUD and DOT. It's being run out of HUD's Office of Sustainable Housing and Communities. The bottom line is that they want to understand what the impact of the combined costs are together and try to figure out how to establish some kind of a baseline for communities to kind of think about. We have created some tools location affordability index and a My Transportation Cost Calculator to kind of help build people's knowledge, planners, researchers, as well as consumer knowledge about the cost together. And we have created a portal, the Location Affordability Portal. It's pretty much a clearinghouse, resources, events, that type of thing, that also hold the tools that you can go to. So we've been working on this project a little more than a year. The tools were delivered to HUD, the website and the two tools were delivered to HUD mid-August. They've completed one iteration beta testing. They have given a lot of feedback to CNT, who is basically building the tool for us. And the second iteration is going to HUD for beta testing today. And so there will be another round. We have about 3 more weeks. They're going to give feedback again. We'll update it. The goal is to have the tool and the portal open for public use by mid-December. Now, I don't know whether you guys are a sustainable community grantee. If you are, you could get in touch with OSHAC, the Office of Sustainable Housing and Communities, and there is a potential you could be part of the beta test. So if you are interested, let me know. I'll put you in touch with HUD because they're actually running the beta test, not us. So another part of this is that we are looking at the impact of HUD programs, actually housing programs and combined costs. You know, how is it we're trying to develop these housing programs to lower and make housing more affordable, but is it more affordable once you add that transportation costs on it? So we've done an analysis of that. And bottom line is that we're trying to figure out, can we develop a new affordability measure? We think of housing as affordable at 30%. Can we develop a new measure that takes housing and transportation together, use that as an affordability measure that's incorporated in how we look at helping our low-income and our moderate-income households? And if we can, what are the ways that we ought to be applying it? So giving you a quick overview, I want to tell you a little bit about some of the key elements because I think that these are really important. So we have a technical review panel. It's got experts from across the country. It's got people who are experts in transportation, in housing, in demographics, in modeling. It's got practitioners as well. So it's not just the people who can sit, you know, way up high and come up with these great ideas. We also have a lot of practitioners saying, okay, how could this actually work? And they've been guiding us from the almost day one in the process. Because we're using CNT's H plus T tool as our starting point, we thought it was really important that we actually do a third-party review, an independent review of it, to say, does it work? What's the good, bad, and ugly of it? Does it work the way we think it should? What can we do to improve it? So we hired a group out of Pennsylvania, UConn, our econ out of the University of Pennsylvania, and Susan Wachter, who used to be with HUD. And they really looked at the tool. They came up with some great recommendations. The bottom line is the tool worked pretty well. Were there places that we could improve it and make sure that it actually worked for communities a little bit more broadly than the H plus T does? Absolutely. But the H plus T itself had, its guts were pretty good. So starting with it as our gut piece was fine. I've already told you a little bit about the web portal. I'll show you some more about it. That's the location affordability portal that's going to hold our tools. We've been working on that for a year. Even though we're going to release that in December, the idea is that as people use it and work on it, you know, work with it, we want feedback. So as people look at it and say, hey, you know, that is not intuitive or that does not make sense, we need that feedback because over the next year, we're going to be improving it and adjusting it as needed to make sure that this is a tool that can be used off the shelf. H plus T is a great tool, but a lot of people have some issues using it off the shelf on their own. They generally need to have a lot of extra technical assistance. So we'll have technical assistance available over the next year, but we do want to make sure that we're getting feedback to make us understand, to help us understand how people can really use it. Doing a lot of marketing outreach to get feedback, part of the reason why I'm here today. We have done several webinars, specifically kind of taking the H plus T or the housing and transportation equation and saying, how does that work with green building? How does it work with health? How does it work if you want to preserve housing? So we've done stuff with the CDC. We've done a webinar with the CDC. We've done a webinar with the National Housing Trust and AARP. We've done webinars with different groups to say, this is how they see this tool can work for them, and how it impacts this particular area, and how you might be able to use it as you work in different areas. We'll be doing several more. I think we have probably about five more that we'll be doing over the next year. We'll be doing an orientation one for anyone who's interested in looking at the location affordability and using it. And we'll probably be doing, that'll probably happen sometime in January. We're also doing field tests. And the field tests are really important to understand, do they actually, you are awesome, do they actually work? You know, it's great when C&T has been, you know, working, they've worked with a lot of communities and they've done some fabulous work. But one of the things is, can a community take it off the shelf and use it the way that they want to use it? And so we've had these field tests going on, and we developed them. So we have got a small rural area, we've got a mid-size area, and we've got a large city. Each of them are doing something somewhat different. So we've done actually two of our site visits. We have been down to Charlottesville, and we went out to Olympia. I'm going to show you some stuff that Charlottesville did in a little bit. And they're kind of using them in different ways. Charlottesville is using the H plus T along with some other tools to help start their consolidated plan. The city of Olympia, Washington, is using it to kind of develop a fair housing plan, a fair share housing, and to look at it for corridor planning. And so there are different ways that they're using it, and they're very different communities. They have very different abilities, GIS abilities, different understanding of the tools and the underlying data. And so it's really important that we work with them to understand what works, what doesn't. And then part of that, the field test also, is to develop a guideline and some tools to help other people. So if you want to do a fair share housing product, how could you use the tool? And again, I've got some other ideas that are based off our analysis. So I mentioned we did the housing program analysis, and that's been really, really interesting. We actually ended up looking at five different programs. I had to change it from HUD programs to housing programs because all of a sudden they threw in low-income housing tax credits, and which of course is needed to be in there, but it's not a HUD program. It's a Treasury program. So we kind of had to adjust the name. But the program analysis was delivered to HUD in last month. They are looking through it. They're asking us to make some changes to it, and so that will be done shortly. But it looked at FHA single family. It looked at housing choice voucher. It looked at home. It looked at, low-income housing tax credit. And it looked at the multifamily mortgage insurance 221D4. To say, how are these programs working? They're supplying housing at this rate. How are they impacting when you put transportation costs on? And overall, we had found some pretty good information and ways that you can use the tool to actually also potentially look at these different programs and improve them. Then right now, we've just started this week, and we'll be doing it over the next couple of weeks. We're convening meetings with the Office of Sustainable Housing and Communities and different program offices in HUD. Because if the HUD program offices don't accept this concept, it's not going to go anywhere. So we've done, during our analysis of the programs, we had a lot of interviews with different HUD folks, a lot of national office, but we also talked to a lot of the field offices. And you'll see some of that. We had great feedback from some of the folks in Colorado, which was very, very helpful. And so we're talking to them right now. Basically, we're doing some briefings for them, and then we're going to sit down and work with them, because all of this is going to basically translate into what are our policy recommendations, but they're not going to be our policy recommendations or C&T's policy recommendations. They've got to be the policy recommendations from the technical review panel, from input that we get from meetings like this, and that type of thing, because we want to make sure that we don't make any recommendations about housing and transportation could be used together that really kind of negates how well a program works or has unintended consequences that makes it not, say, the low-income housing tax credit not workable in certain communities. We want to make sure that it's a workable policy instead of just doing, again, you know, the high and mighty, looking at it from a policy spectrum but not a practitioner spectrum. Another thing I should mention is we just provided a kind of a memo to HUD on looking at how we could think about housing and transportation, not just the program analysis, but how to start, what kind of applications and how we might start thinking about housing and transportation as an affordable affordability measure. And a lot of the elements of the project actually kind of work together, and they will come together in this final report, final policy report. So I mentioned that the Location Affordability Index is based in large part on the H+T index that CNT has created. What does it actually include? So what it looks at is a household. It looks at how many people are in the house. You know, how many commuters are there? Two commuters, one commuter, a couple of kids. What's the household income? Then it looks at some independent neighborhood variables and says, okay, what's the density? What's the connectivity, the street connectivity? Can you get out of your community? When we were, this is a really good thing, when we were, not good thing, interesting observation, when we were in Charlottesville, they had these great communities that looked really walkable. They had, and it was kind of wild, they had really walkable communities. They even had bike trails throughout the community, bike lanes. But they were set so that you actually couldn't get out. Because even though right across the street there are boatloads of great services, you couldn't actually cross the street. You couldn't get to them. You know, so within the community it was great, but they couldn't actually get to the services because they couldn't get across the street. They couldn't get beyond the community. And they didn't have any of those services within the community itself. Or if they did, they were in weird little strip malls that even those somehow were outside of the walkable area. So it's kind of like looking at making, looking at the walkability, looking at the connectivity, you know, making sure that you can get to where you need to go. And then also looking at transit. What's the transit access? What's the connectivity? CNT has put together a thing that they call All Transit. They've looked at transit connectivity, the service and the frequency in jurisdictions across the country, and they've built this system that does that looks at this. It's very odd. DOT doesn't have anything like that because every community tracks that themselves. So they're talking to DOT to see how can, going forward, DOT pick up some of this and do it going forward. And then the last thing is jobs access. I mentioned this is not something that should just be used for, you know, thinking about it as a core urban, but it's also where are the jobs and is the location near a jobs hub, excuse me. Then it takes a bunch of dependent variables. It looks at the how many cars do a household own. It looks at how many vehicle miles traveled does the household incorporate or use on an annual basis. And again, what's the public transit use? What's your journey to work scaled? What's your total trips taken, that type of thing? And those combined give you your household transportation costs. So I should mention that there are some differences. In the H+T model that CNT created, they didn't have a model for housing. They just used census tract, and that was problematic for a lot of people. So we've actually tried to model it so that it actually gets a little bit closer to what housing costs are now. Because the bottom line is, many of you know, with the fluctuation in housing costs, what might have seemed affordable 10 years ago or when the census tract was, well, now 2010, but like the last thing before they did this update, you could look at it and it, a community might be completely affordable from a housing standpoint, but when you tried to buy into that community, you couldn't. So trying to deal with that, modeling that a little bit different. We also went, ran into a problem. A lot of transportation modeling uses AAA numbers, and AAA has come back and said, you know, we didn't actually mean for you to use those numbers that way. So we don't want you to use the numbers that way. So now we're looking at how do we model some of that. And we are working with DOT. I mentioned DOT as part of this project. Two things that I didn't mention is that DOT kind of, they didn't really come to the project late, but they came with a couple of things late. So one of the things that we're working on right now is how to adjust looking at auto costs. And so we're looking at different variables. We're looking at the, I think that they finally have decided that we should be using the Consumer Expenditure Survey and then the National Household Transportation Survey and using them combined. And so CNT is trying to come up with a different model that DOT will approve. We also are doing a paper on parking costs to kind of have, how do we look at parking costs? How do we actually incorporate that more into our auto costs in a better way? So this is a mock-up of our homepage. I'm going to show you a couple of things. And I should mention that because, of course, this is a beta test, things are changing. And we're going to run into that in a minute as I walk you through it. So as I said, this is a tool that we really want people, researchers, planners, developers, consumers, realtors, we really want a lot of different types of people to use this. And so we've kind of tried to break it down to make sure that people understand what tools are there. Because the core of this, really the crux of this, is the Location Affordability Index, we've tried to make it that very highlighted. And that's really kind of targeted, the LAI is really targeted to planners and researchers. And it gives you the big picture. So how you would use this is when you go to the Location Affordability Index, if you plug that in on the website, you're going to get a site that looks like that. What you do is you put in your community and, you know, hit search, and it gives you your community. So I put in Prince George's County. It highlights the outlined area is the community. And you can see from this, this is a regional typical household. This gives you the income. It tells you, you know, how many people are in each household, the commuters, and it gives you your Location Affordability Index, which is basically the housing and transportation numbers combined. And it tells you what the average regional household looks like. At the bottom, you would kind of have done this so that you get colors. You can tell that the darkest colors are the most location efficient. The lightest colors are the least location efficient. So say you did this, but you didn't really, this gives you the regional typical. One of the problems that people had with the H+T is it gave you the regional typical, but that was about it. It also gave you 80%. But that doesn't really help you if you're trying to look at different income levels or if you're trying to use this tool for an affordability. So you can click on certain things. You can click on regional typical. You'll get a description of what that means. You can also now change your household type. So if you click on household type, it gives you a drop-down. And it gives you several different types of household. So we were not able to actually model every household. Because that is just not possible within the scope of what they're trying to do. Potentially going forward, we can do that. So what we've decided to do is we took several different household types and we modeled them according to that. So we've got this drop down, but I wanted to give you, this is what the household types that we've come up with thus far. One of the feedback that we got when we did our field test site visit last week was, in fact, that this one with the one worker family and five household actually doesn't quite make sense because, well, it says one worker, but in fact, a lot of times you've got two workers and two people commuting, and they're still both commuting, they're still pretty low income, and so we might need to adjust that. Another suggestion that we got was apparently Esri has some typical households that they use, and a lot of planning organizations are working with Esri and use those typical households, and we might look at those to incorporate. We haven't figured that one out yet. Okay, so from there, say you're on the site and you want to click to a specific census block, census tract. You can click in an area, and what will happen is it will take you straight to that tract. It will tell you the tract number. It will tell you the community. So now, I mentioned this is in beta testing. I was able to put this together, and then when I went to do the next part, they had taken the site down to fix it. So we're going to have to kind of switch gears a little bit. But one of the other things that when we were working with the technical review panel, they said, you know, this is really great, but what would be really perfect is if you could take this Location Affordability Index and link it to the My Transportation Cost Calculator. So the My Transportation Cost Calculator is more of a consumer tool, whereas this is a tool that planners can use. So the interesting thing about this tool is that planners can use it to map different things. You can use it to kind of help make your case when you're looking to meetings, like public meetings, or even with funders and that type of thing. And I'm going to show you a couple of ways to do that in a minute. But we also are going to link to the My Transportation Cost Calculator in a minute. But let me show you this. So about the user guide and methodology. This stuff is really, really important. One of the biggest things that that H+T users had a problem with is that they didn't understand what methodology was being used. The new H+T now includes an area on methodology. So if you're a GIS person or if you're somebody who really needs to understand those underlying variables, how they're used, how they're weighted, you can find that information right now. So that if you need to kind of make some adjustments for yourself, it may not be able to provide the map for you, but you can do it on your own using, you know, your knowledge. The other thing is that you can now download the data directly. It used to be that if you were working with CNT and the H+T, you really couldn't download the data and get to the underlying variables. Now you can do that. And what it does is if you were to click on the download data, you get this whole listing. Right now, the it's not populated yet. But then you go to your particular state and you can go to the what you're looking for. You know, is it a community? Is it a track level? Is it the census-based survey area? Whatever it is that you're looking for, you can click on that area and get the data specifically, which becomes very, very important when you're trying to use this tool as more than just kind of a fuzzy idea. So I said that they also link to the My Transportation Cost Calculator. So while this tool is something that's kind of a broader tool, you can download the maps, you can highlight the maps and use them in your community, you can do a lot of different things. I'm going to show you some of those maps, how the H+T has been used in some applications. You can also click to the My Transportation Calculator. So what normally would happen is you would click on My Transportation Cost Calculator, and you would be sent to kind of the middle of that particular area that's highlighted right now. Because I couldn't do that, we're going to go to Jackson, Mississippi. I had done this for another group, and so that's where we go. And what happens is when it goes to there, it gives you the typical household information for that particular area. So in Jackson, Mississippi, you know, you've got household size 2.65 people. Not really. Of course, you have a lot of people with four people in a household, two people in a household, whatever. And it gives you the typical regional information for that particular community. But what you can do is go back in and give it your own information to say, well, we actually have four people living in my household. Our average annual income is only $58,000, and only one person in the household goes to work. You can put in your work area, you know, so where are you generally commuting to? And so you get a better sense of the distances you're traveling. You can put in your specific household costs to say, I'm a renter, I'm an owner, and this is my cost. So these are my household costs. We don't need to look at we're going to look at the typical regional as a comparison, but I'm going to get a figure that's based on my information. And then it looks at the household vehicles. And basically, if you don't know what the gas price, you can put the average in. You can click on that, and it will give you an average cost in the region that you live in. Same thing if you don't know your miles per gallon. You can put it in and get a sense, based on your car, what it is. Then you update the numbers, and lo and behold, what it does is it gives you a sense of what your household looks like as compared to the typical regional household in that neighborhood. And what that allows you to do is say, wow, okay, well, you know, I might be able to lower my costs here, or if I live in this community, I might be able to walk more, that type of thing. You might also look at these numbers and say, you know, that still didn't quite calculate it the way I think it should. And so you can go look at this and say, I need to edit some of this information. You can say, you know, I know it says that similar households drive this many miles, but I drive this many miles. I know that. You know, I know that I spend this much in parking and tolls. You know, I know that this is how much I use to take the metro every month. And you can put in that data yourself. You hit the reset button, and it adjusts it so that you have a better sense, again, of your household compared to the typical regional household in that community. So you can get to that through the Location Affordability Index. You can also get it to it from the main page. If you go to it from the main page, you're going to, and you click on My Transportation Cost Calculator, what it will do is give you a picture of the country, and you put in your home address yourself, and it goes straight to that. You don't, you know, it, you're not going through the gyrations of going through the track and then adding other information. So now I need to get caught up with my own notes. Okay. So what else does this have? We have our news and events. And what we're trying to do is, if we have webinars, they'll be posted on here. If we have workshops coming up, it'll be posted on here. If we hear about really good conferences or conferences that relate to the planning and housing and transportation, we're going to post it on here. Things that HUD's working on, we'll be posting here, especially as it relates to housing and transportation. We haven't updated this recently, but we will be doing it shortly to include things like the new Partners for Smart Growth. I don't know whether you guys have ever gone to that or know about that conference. It's a fabulous conference. Excuse me, it's got basically almost every different element from housing, transportation, environmental, water. They bring all together in one conference, and it's a phenomenal conference. This year it's in Kansas City. The other thing that we want to do is make sure that this is kind of a clearinghouse for information. So resources. As we hear about articles and reports that relate to this or things that have been done, there are a lot of articles that we've found over the past year or so that relate to these issues or talk about how housing and transportation impact economic development. And so we'll be posting those to make sure people have access to it. If you hear of anything, you have anything you want highlighted, let us know. We'll put it up there. Okay. So here's where I normally have one of my colleagues from the Center for Neighborhood Technology with me. But this time I don't. So I think I can get through it pretty well. But if you have questions, I think I can answer them. But if I can't, I'll have to give you up front. Then I may have to write questions down and come back to you. So I mentioned Center for Neighborhood Technology has been working on this issue for about 10 years. And basically what happened is they started looking at housing and transportation costs, and they realized there's no real good benchmark. You know, we have the housing standard at 30%. But what's the transportation costs? What, you know, how do they fit into this equation? And they started working with it, and they knew that the typical is 18% right now. But basically they wanted to maybe adjust that to make it a little bit more affordable and kind of figure out how we can get a better target. So they look at the neighborhood level block groups in their H plus T. But what they came down to is they said, let's give it a healthy bump, 15%. So they came up with a standard, and this is their standard. This is not HUD standard. There are some communities that have adopted this standard, just so you know. But they came up with a good what they feel is a good benchmark for what housing and transportation costs ought to target. It works pretty well in urban areas, not so well in more rural areas, just FYI. And as I said, it's really important to say this is their standard. HUD hasn't adopted it yet or probably won't, but it is kind of a good benchmark. And one of the things that they did as they started working with this is that they realized they had a lot of lessons learned, but the biggest thing that they found is that when you look at neighborhoods across the country, 3 out of 4 of them look affordable when you just look at housing costs. But once you add just that 15% on top, it goes down to about 28%. Kind of it flips that only 28% of the neighborhoods across the country are affordable. So there are a lot of different ways that they have found that they can use the housing and transportation data. And so as a proxy for the Location Affordability Index, I'm going to be talking mostly about how they have learned. The first one is public outreach. So this is one tool that they use, and I'm sorry some of these didn't quite work. This is one of the ones that I think is really profound and I think kind of gets people right away. So if you were to look using the H plus T, you can use the LAI as well, you look at housing availability at 30%. It looks like there's a fair amount of housing. This is in, again, St. Louis. They have a lot of things in St. Louis area. Once you add 15%, for transportation, all of a sudden the affordability declines dramatically. And if you start looking at it from more of a moderate income level, you all of a sudden realize there's almost no place that's affordable using that 45% benchmark. And this is a pretty compelling thing to show, kind of get people starting to wrap their head around it. Okay. I mentioned that we were in Charlottesville, and I wanted to show you what Charlottesville is working on. They use the H plus T plus some of their own local data, and they're developing this messaging, this marketing plan to help them as they talk to stakeholders about their consolidated plan, how they ought to be putting it together, as well as look at some transportation corridors that they're doing. And what they did was they looked at several different communities in the area, and they targeted 6 particular neighborhoods. And this is the ring around Charlottesville from the middle and how far out. So the Crozet, the Forest Lakes, and the Lake Monticello are communities that are pretty well, apparently, good-sized communities that are part of Charlottesville, this region, the Thomas Jefferson Planning District Commission. And so they use these to target, to kind of look at the different examples. Now, in this particular one, I left up the Crozet. The Crozet is probably one of the more rural areas that they have in this community, and it doesn't have as many services as some of the others. But we thought that how they put it together was pretty interesting because it does make it very compelling. It's very understandable for a lot of folks because they're using this in public engagement. You know, it tells you what the average housing cost is in Crozet, what the transportation costs are. It gives you an idea of what the density is so that people kind of have an understanding about why the housing and the transportation costs together might look like that. And it also gives you a context of what the street connectivity is. So in Crozet, it's actually got some, you know, good connectivity, but you'll also see that some of the streets, like, they end and they don't match up. They don't link to other areas. And so that's one of the things that they want people to understand, how the connectivity plays a role in this. So this is another thing. This is, CNT actually does some studies for, I think it's 8 or 10 communities. They do it as a standard. This one happens to be in the D.C. area, so of course I had to use it. And it basically, again, looks at 72% of the neighborhoods in the D.C. area look affordable when you just think housing costs. But once you add transportation costs, that goes down to 61%. And the interesting thing is that if you look at the housing costs for the different areas, in this particular one, it's DuPont Circle, which, of course, is very, very urban. College Park, which is Prince George's County and actually is fairly urban. And Damascus, which is pretty fairly rural in a lot of ways in my mind. The housing costs are pretty similar. But it's the transportation costs that actually takes it up. And then this shows, they do this and they give pictures so people have a sense, you know, taking the data down a little bit more so you see how many autos, you know, what's the vehicle miles travel, what's the commute like, that type of thing. This is another slide that actually I was at doing a presentation in Texas, and we didn't use this slide, but the folks in Texas did. Because this is another slide. It's not actually a CNT. It's a Center for Transit-Oriented Development, which is one of their partners. Mm-hmm. But it gives people a quick understanding, I think, about if you live in a transit-rich neighborhood, this is your cost. But the farther you move out and the more auto-dependent you become, this is what you're going to end up contending with. And a lot of people get that pretty quickly. This is one that Center for Neighborhood Technology did, and it actually ties very closely to the report that the Center for Housing Policy is producing as well. The Center for Housing Policy, at least in their heavy load, they showed metropolitan regions across the country and the different housing and transportation costs. This one looks at different areas and talks about location efficiency, and you can do this within your community by looking at different communities within Prince George's County. This is, again, D.C. area, and, again, it's actually included some stuff that's in Prince George's County. They have three different areas, and basically they say this is the most urban, the suburban, and the exurban. Again, what you find is the housing costs, they don't vary that much. It's the transportation costs in almost every case is where you get it. And when you pull out these, you can kind of see it a little bit clearer. Basically, you live in Adams Morgan, again, fairly dense, compared to Calvert Beach. You're going to spend about, you know, more than $4,000 more just on transportation costs in a year. So these are the types of use of the H+T data that people are using to basically, you know, in public meetings to get it across. This is another one that was pretty interesting. This was not done by CNT, but done by a group called Transform, which is based in the San Francisco Bay Area. And they looked at communities in California to say, okay, if your household or your neighborhood has a lot of good transportation options, this is what you're paying versus other communities. And what they found is that, you know, that difference is huge. If you have transit options and transportation, if you have a lot of transportation options and your costs go down and you have better access, that the amount of money that's staying in your community is huge. And it's not just for the household, but it's in the community itself. And that means it extrapolates. so that it's a benefit, an economic benefit for the community. So this chart actually shows that on average, 39% less households with the best access to transit spend about 39% less than how than communities with not with without good access. Okay, some other ways to look at this data is kind of to guiding place-based incentives and investments, that type of thing. So this is actually a slide that that came out of our housing policy study. And I mentioned that we couldn't do, well, I don't know if I mentioned this. We couldn't look at every single community across the country beyond the scope. So we had to select five states, and we looked at like five or eight different communities. This is actually in Denver. And it's a map of the Denver area, and it breaks down into the low efficiency, basically high efficiency, location efficiency, low poverty, low location efficiency, high poverty. And the thing that's really important about this is that the yellow areas, obviously, they indicate where there's low rates of poverty and high location efficiency. The points on the map are directly three of the programs we looked at. The red dots are tax credit projects, the green dots are home rental projects, and the black dots are the 221D4 projects. And what we found is that when you looked at this, you could actually take a map like this, plot out where you're using it right now. And one of the things that we're talking about, how do we do this? We don't want to concentrate poverty. But all too often, some of our housing programs, they end up promoting that just because people are living where the housing is less and that type of thing. But if you look at these, you have some areas that there's low poverty. It's not a high, there's not a concentration. It's a location-efficient place. You could actually help people start living there. You could do incentives. You could do all kinds of things. You could say, you could maybe give extra subsidies for people to live in different places. And that's what they're trying to promote. That's one of the things that we provided to HUD. We looked at Baltimore in the same way. This actually is a similar type of map, but it actually looks at the annual gas costs, because even though we said gas costs is only one element, it is one thing that goes up and down and people kind of recognize. So this plots the same kind of information in the Baltimore region. So you can also use this for performance measurements. San Francisco Bay actually had used the H+T information for great success, in fact, because what they did was they looked at this and they said, we really want to lower the transportation costs and combined costs. We want to come up with a target. Right now it's about 55%. We want to bring it down to 45%. But, how hard is that if we don't have extra subsidies for affordable housing? And so they use the tool and they use the metrics, the performance metrics, to actually go to their MPO and go to funders and say, if we came up with a really good transit-oriented development fund, we could actually provide more affordable housing using this fund. We probably can't target lower income unless we have this. And what ended up happening is the MPO kind of flipped some money around, came up with the seed money for a $10 million fund that foundations have also supported. But it was the data that they were able to use and the presentation that provided them, here's how we could use this funding if you look at the housing and transportation information together. So somebody mentioned bus rapid transit earlier. So this is a bus rapid transit corridor. This is actually this study was actually done by an advocacy group in Chicago. When I first looked at it, I thought it was the Chicago group. It's the Metropolitan Planning Council, but in fact, it's an advocacy group. It's a nonprofit. They wanted to figure out where should there be more bus rapid transit corridors, and they wanted to promote the idea with the transit authority. So what they did was they took several different selection criteria. The H+T index or data was only one of those. It was actually the one to promote equitable livability, affordable housing. And they looked at all these criteria and they mapped out the communities that needed and could use and would benefit even the bus rapid transit. And they ended up being able to take that data and identify 10 different corridors that the transit authority actually ended up supporting, saying, this is going to increase the livability in the community, it's going to, lower the travel time for the people who live here, and it's going to have some really good environmental impacts. And the transit authority used that information to move forward with it. This is another example that was done in Chicago. It's actually looking at where low-income housing tax credit projects have been built. And even in this, they found some very different different data. The three different areas are urban, suburban, exurban, and all of these are rentals. And that was one of the things when CNT was working on it was really important to recognize. They've done a lot of work around housing from a home ownership, but these are all rentals. And even this, what they were looking at is saying, okay, we're putting our housing in places where there's actually a fairly large jobs mismatch. And so if we want to put people where they can get jobs, we need to do a little bit better job at it. But what they did was they put together this chart to say, okay, here are the different communities. Here's how much they are traveling. Here's the jobs that are within that are accessible to the people with the income at that level. And these are the type of tools that are actually, they can be very, very compelling, not only for public engagement to get people to support different issues, but also for council, for, you know, public officials. This is another one along those lines. This was a study that was done in Asheville, North Carolina. And what it did was say, okay, here are areas that the orange are location efficient areas that don't get incentives to build affordable housing there or moderate level housing. The blue are where there are incentives, but they're not location efficient. And so the study wanted to say, okay, let's figure this out. There is some overlap, but there's also some, you know, it shows some data that says maybe we need to be putting our incentives where it's more location efficient and people can get to jobs and have access. So, okay, so consumer information. So just as is important as the information about where we invest our money, it's really important for people to figure out where they're investing their own money. And so what CNT has been doing is working with several different communities to look at how can you use these tools for consumers. So my transportation cost calculator, I mentioned that was more of a consumer-oriented tool, or hope I mentioned that. But so they have a similar tool that they had already developed just for three localities. CNT had worked with ULI and the Center for Housing Policy to develop a cost calculator for D.C., for San Francisco, and Boston. And just recently they did one for the Twin Cities. The HUD project said, okay, that's great, but we want to broaden it. Just like, in fact, we've done for the Location Affordability Index. The Location Affordability Index is much broader than H plus T. It covers a wider part of the country. In fact, it covers 944 communities, which basically is about 94% of the population. And now what's happened is the My Transportation Cost Calculator is also available in all those communities. So what they've done, what CNT has done so far, is actually worked with housing counselors to say, how can you use this in your discussions with people when they're looking to buy a home or where they're going to live or even rent? And they use it so that it's much more understandable to the average, you know, home buyer or the average person looking for a place to live. And they've developed a lot of guidelines and different tools. They have worked with the housing counselors to develop specific materials that focus on the people who are looking for homes. And so that they can really take in the transportation information and that data to make more informed decisions. It's not always going to change anything. One of the areas that they've worked with is in El Paso. And in El Paso, they were finding, well, people weren't really still using it, and they wanted to know why. And the reason why is that they wanted to live in the neighborhoods where their family lived or their, you know, own ethnic groups lived. And so they were moving to those communities even though they weren't getting the benefit. But the other side of that, at least they knew before they moved, and they could, you know, you can incorporate some of their transportation costs in there as well. So funding. This is a project that CNT worked on in Cincinnati. It's basically, I know D.C. is building the streetcars. Is that coming up into Prince George's County? Is it not? Okay, because at one point I know that the streetcar came all the way up into Mount Rainier. And
the light rail project.
The light rail. Okay, so what they did in Cincinnati is that this was already planned, but what they did was they kind of looked at it to say, Okay, we have a lot of employment opportunities, but we don't have a way to get a lot of the low-income folks to those employment opportunities. So let's take a look at this and try to figure out how do we do it better. And even though this map shows all this, this is actually the main area. The urban core is where the streetcar was being built. And they wanted to say, how do we link the streetcar? How do we make sure that there's affordability in there? So they used data from the H plus T along with locally available data to kind of figure out what some of the development strengths were in the short term and the long term. They used the H plus T data and they overlaid it, as I said, with the locally available, things like where do we have parcels of land that are developable, and where do we have access already? Where is there land that the city owns that we could tap into? Things like that. Where could we put incentives? And they identified some very specific places for the short term and some very specific places for the long term. And in the end, basically, it worked out very well because they ended up getting $25 million based on this analysis from the federal government. They also ended up getting a huge grant from the Ohio Department of Transportation. Unfortunately, the governor rescinded that grant, but Cincinnati, because the analysis had been so clear and they really kind of looked at it as an economic development tool for them, they're going ahead with it. And basically, it should be working, should be up and running in about another 2 years. And the bottom line is that the data really showed how the investment could connect to the employment centers, build more affordability and regional access. So one of the things that CNT likes to point out is this is the area that they studied. There are all these other areas that still don't link. These especially are still fairly high employment areas, but they're pretty far out. So at some point, the city's going to have to go back or the jurisdiction's going to have to go back and kind of take another study to say, okay, let's do the same thing in these areas. Okay. They've done a lot of studies on planning and performance across the country. They've done a lot of reports. The Beltway Burden obviously was one done here. They've done in the Boston area, Pennywise, Pound Foolish, basically looking at, we think we're saving money here, but once you actually add up all the costs, you're not. This is the one that they worked on for Metropolitan Washington COG, and basically what it ends up saying is that, you know, COG has adopted the 45%. They're saying this is what in our region we ought to be promoting, and this is what our goal is. In Chicago, they did that. They adopted that as well in their regional planning, and basically they're trying to get it down from, they're currently around 55, and they're trying to get it down to 45. This is another thing that is useful. You mentioned, okay, so if there's light rail going in, this is a kind of a different thing. This is a study. It's basically to figure out what happens when the rail goes in or the corridor has more transit. Right now in this community in the Twin Cities, this is a funders collaborative, and they have come together and said, okay, we're going to use this data to track the changes and to make sure that as things change, we're actually implementing policies in some cases before they change, in some cases in reaction to the change, to say right now the central corridor, here are the different areas that the transit and the people who are able to live there. The central corridor is pretty affordable on the most part, but once the transit and once the higher level of transit goes in, they anticipate that flipping because that very often does happen. And so they're going to track it. And they're going to track it on a, I'm not sure if it's a quarterly or annual basis, to make sure that two things. One, that they put extra money into some of the areas to ensure that there's some more affordability and to help pursue policy so that there's not just the investment but also things that help people stay in their communities, help people build in the communities as transit-oriented is being done. But it's kind of a long-term thing that they're using the housing and transportation affordability, the index for, and you could use the location affordability index as well to track things, to make sure, okay, we put this in place, but we want to make sure that we don't disrupt the families that have lived there or change the community too dramatically or make sure that we're not pushing people out, or if it looks like it is, what do we do to fix it? So this is one I have less information about, but I thought it was kind of important because you guys are planners this is something, again, it's a group, the group in San Francisco did Transform, and they looked at it and they used the H plus T data to kind of figure out, okay, based on the H plus T data and transportation access, what does that mean for how our community is being impacted by CO2 and the different areas and the different, you know, income levels, who's being impacted by the pollutant at a higher rate. And this is a piece that they put together, looks at this, it looks at different areas and says this is what we need to do, basically to figure out how we can improve it. I'm sorry I don't have more information. I probably shouldn't have included it in the presentation, but I thought it was kind of a, you should check it out just to kind of look at it to figure out, is this something that's important for Prince George's County? If environmental issues are becoming a key element in the community, is there a way that you can use H plus T to address some of those environmental issues? So then finally, before we move to Q&A, or actually to Kip, I think, and then to Q&A, I wanted to show you this. So I mentioned we have a technical review panel. So on our technical review panel is a guy named Chris Zimmerman. I don't know if any of you have ever heard of him. Probably. So Chris Zimmerman is a city council member in Arlington County. And Arlington County has gotten a lot of rave reviews on their transit corridor. And the first time I saw Chris was at a presentation about 7 years ago, and he was doing this presentation. Maybe it was 6 years ago. And so what
he
this is...
Popular, pardon? Excuse me, he was popular TPG.
Exactly. And that's the thing. So he did this presentation. It's a great presentation. So he puts up Virginia Square, this pre-metro, 1981, shows where this station entrance is going to be. And you can see from this is not very walkable, not very scalable, not very pleasant area. And it just says, you know, but it was scheduled to have a metro built. So what they did was they put a lot of thought into it. This is the, you know, Roslyn to Boston corridor. They put a lot of thought into it. You know, how do they have different themes for each station? They have very detailed urban design. They brought in a lot of different partners from not just Metro, but also the private sector, the office, you know, bus transfer, the hotel, commercial. And from an economic development standpoint, they did really pretty well. Since those were put in, and this is, by the way, very outdated because I used his slides. I need to update them, but this was a presentation he did in 2006. So obviously this is very different. But since the stations went in and started being used, basically they dramatically increased their office space and they dramatically increased their housing units. They also got more people to use Metro, which is great from an environmental standpoint and everything else. You know, they have more, a lot of people using bus trips to get to the rail. One of the things that's been really interesting is that they have a fair amount of transit-related and bike commutes. As the bike share has moved out there, I'm sure that that's increased dramatically as well, whereas people are picking up a bike in their own community, riding to the rail, leaving the bike, and then taking the rail. And so not only has this had a benefit in lowering congestion, lowering pollution, it's also probably increasing the health in the community. So now this is what it looks like today. And basically, the corridor runs up along here, and he shows this. And you can see it's much more scalable. The taller buildings are closer to the nodes. You've got the environment, the housing moving farther out, which all works pretty well. But this is what struck me about his presentation. So I always have to show this because it looks great from a transportation standpoint and even a community standpoint. So when Chris Zimmerman did the presentation, he said, so we felt pretty good. We've got great results. But what do we get wrong? So the next slide that he had, which I don't have, is the first bullet was housing. And he talked about how they didn't think about housing at different income levels when they were doing their design. They were thinking about it as a, you know, design from housing and the scalability and everything, but they didn't think about affordability or what kind of different income levels. And then the next bullet, housing. It was, okay, so because we didn't think about it, we have to think about it now. But now we have to think about it but it's like trying to, you know, close the door after the horse got out, and the barn door after the horse got out. And so it, basically what it ended up is the whole slide was about 8 bullets that only said housing, and he talked about what they got wrong in relationship to housing, because they hadn't thought about housing and transportation together. They had thought about economic development. They had thought about, you know, some other things, but they really hadn't thought about housing from an affordability impact at all. And so I like to leave with that just to say, okay, they're trying to fix it now. They're running into all kinds of problems. They wanted to do inclusionary zoning. Unfortunately, Virginia is a Dillon state and not a home rule state, so they tried to do that, and the Virginia legislature smacked it down. So now, you know, they're doing some voluntary things with the developers, but it's very difficult to go back and fix what you don't do in the beginning. So as you're looking at the light rail, as you're looking at transportation corridors and different things like that, it's always important to put in, make sure those elements are thought about together. So with that, I'm happy to take questions, but I think the Q&A is after Kip has some things she wants to talk about first, and then do some Q&A. What?
You just said it for me.
Noreen and I see each other twice a year, usually at parties. We never talk work, but last year we did, and she talked about this project, and she needed a guinea pig, and I said, well, you should come to Prince George's County. We'll give you some good feedback. I think Noreen just said it perfectly. For the general plan, there's some really basic issues that we need to look at in terms of transportation affordability, placemaking. We have some of the highest cost burden households are in the developing tier. The last census said that we have 45% of our households are cost burden alone. 41 are owner households, and 52 are renter households, and most of those are in the developed tier. So we need to really think about, when we're doing our placemaking and our TOD prioritization, how we're going to address housing and transportation costs. I think the other interesting thing was the link to health and environment, because we have high obesity rates for children and adults, and that's a public health issue that we also need to address through walkability, design of our communities, and increasing our bike share infrastructure, funding for bus facilities, and also planning for the light rail that's coming. So that's all I really want to talk about and show that link, because I think it's a good tool that we can look to our master plans, the general plan, but also for DHCD and others to utilize that. DHCD is about to come up on their 5-year consolidated plan, and they're planning for their new programs. And I know that the housing department is looking at sort of their new goals for housing, and I think that everyone in the region will be adopting this 45% sort of goal indicator. So I guess if we have any questions for Noreen, it's a good time.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I thought it was interesting to think about TODs as a sink for the extra savings that you can have. I mean, so you can see right there where a neighborhood near the metro station, there's more available dollars to spend. That neighborhood is going to have a competitive advantage. But so that was really interesting. And so my question is then, one thing it may not be as sensitive to, and you talked about this, is the connectivity and the walkability and the number of services in there, that walk score, because I've read recently talks about that one of the most important things for dampening vehicle ownership is the number of services that are within the walkable radius, not just one or two, but you have 5 or 6 places that you normally go.
Right.
That really has an effect on the dampening. But my question is related to something else. Is there any pushback about bias it might create? Because you have cities competing against each other, communities competing. And if you're not capturing all the factors, I'm sure you have a lot of people asking.
That's funny. We
about
have,
all that going in.
I would lay. We haven't been asked that, but I do know that, for example, D.C. Planning Department used H+D data and some of their own data to develop their own marketing plan to bring people back into the city. So that would be a bias against you all, potentially. We haven't really heard very much pushback against that. But at the same time, we've gotten pushback from other areas. For example, people who might be afraid that if they develop in an area that they won't have the infrastructure support that a community or a city might give them.
If the city becomes savvier and
if the city says, okay, well, you know, we want to be in stewards of our investment, and we're not going to do the infrastructure out there, or we're not going to support it, and we're going to adopt this, say, 45% or even 48%, then all of a sudden there might be some folks that are not happy about that, because wait a minute, we want you to pay for that infrastructure moving out there. What you talked about the number of services, we actually do talk about when I talk to rural communities, because, you know, you can't just say, okay, get rid of farming communities. You can't get rid of suburban communities or anything like that. But what you do need to do is make sure that there are more services centrally located, so that if you are in a rural community, or even if you're in a community, you know, like the communities throughout Prince George's County, is there a way that you're going to get more of your services in one place, and can you walk to them? AARP came and did a presentation with us, for us, and they had an interesting thing that they looked at, which is there are a lot of places that look like they could be affordable and accessible, but they started looking at curb cuts. So here's a bus that's like a half a block away, but the curb cut, even though like the development, the senior development's here, and the bus stop's only half a block away, the curb cut's actually over here. So it means it's not a half a block. It ends up being, you know, almost 3 blocks or 4 blocks because they can't get to it. And so it's also thinking about not just is there a bus stop, is there transit and the service, but is there access to it? Is there some kind of connectivity to get there?
I might be able to work level of service into it.
Yeah.
We've been asked to prepare some guidelines related to that.
Yeah. And you know, but that's the thing. So those are often the things that are kind of overlooked, or, you know, we don't think about it. I did a presentation in Ohio many years ago, and it was actually a presentation for housers, looking at, you know, where's money for housing, and I had just learned about the congestion mitigation funds. And I said, you know, and I started looking in Ohio, and I said, well, you guys do your transportation funding kind of funky here. They may still well do it this way, I don't know, but it was that every single county got the same amount of money, no matter whether you're Hamilton, I think it's Hamilton, really rural community, or Cuyahoga, which is where Cleveland is, everybody got the same amount of money. But then they didn't actually get involved in the say-so. And so my point was housers and community development groups have to get involved in transportation and vice versa, because the transportation people need to understand, you know, don't take access away when something's being built or there's affordable housing complex already there. Building something new is too expensive. But if there's already an affordable housing complex there, for God's sakes, don't take away the access to transit. Or if there's a commercial corridor, don't take away the access to transit. And at the same time, the housers need to get involved to say, don't take away the access to transit. And, oh, by the way, we'd like to do this, and we think it can be a commercial boost and an economic boost, but we need to work with you guys to figure out how to make sure that the transit and the road is coming to us and is built in a scalable manner. Yeah.
One of the charts you showed, there's something that was sort of bothering me. It was shown in scales of tens of miles, and we've been talking about
closer.
Walkable, which
right.
is hundreds of feet. So my question is, it didn't look like quite right to me, because I know that housing is much more expensive within walking distance.
Right.
Normally, especially new houses, you're not comparing quality or anything. So what I was wondering if maybe, the other thing I was wondering that's sort of related to that is, what was the smallest unit of geography you were using to measure? And did they align to where the transit stops were? Because that could throw all the numbers
off. So that's
off.
A great question. The problem is it was a CNT study, and I don't know that. From conversations, because they've been asked kind of that question before, from my understanding, is that they've done it as close as about 2 miles, which is still kind of a bikeable area. But this particular study, they were looking at, you know, kind of range of jobs, and that was what they could find. And they were actually looking at the number of jobs, and they were trying to be, I'm gonna, this would not be the word, I think they were trying to be generous. and saying, okay, 10 miles out, given that the break between the commuting and affordability is 10 to 12 miles, I think they were going out 10 miles to say, okay, within that 10-mile radius, yes, we want walkability, but if we also are talking about the affordability factor and the impact on transportation costs and affordability housing costs comes at that 10 to 12-mile break, what are the jobs within the 10-mile? Does that make sense? Not... But they're looking for the break-even point, kind of.
Well, they weren't so micro-focused on access to transit. It doesn't sound like it's more of a general economic analysis.
It was more of a, exactly. It was more of an economic, not just transit. It was definitely an economic standpoint.
I guess I was kind of piggybacking on that, and that I think it's the same slide. And I was a little thrown off, and I don't know whether it was simplifying it too much, because I'm thinking, okay, you know, the same thing. You're close to transit, your housing cost is higher, but then you have the low-income housing in an urban area, and then their transportation, but they're predominantly on public transit. They're not; they don't even own cars. So is that
which is actually why their transit cost is lower. And I'm going to say that up front, that a lot of the transportation modeling is really based more on your auto costs,
right? That's
than your transit costs.
Yeah. So
and they have not, and CNT, and even in the LAI, they have not been able to figure out, because every jurisdiction has very different transit costs.
Exactly.
And so one of the problems that they've run into, even, you know, I mentioned earlier that CNT had to develop the all transit, and they took, I don't even know how many communities, and they looked at the connectivity and the service frequency and all that, because nobody does it. And they were the ones who pulled it together.
Right.
Same thing. The differences in the transit costs themselves, I mean, DC is fairly expensive, in my opinion.
Right, and the cost of transit, then you have expensive
transit. And I was thinking it more just even transit.
Yeah.
You know, the idea was that it was going to get people to jobs faster. I mean, and it can, but it's very expensive.
Right.
There are other jurisdictions that have kind of a set price, and it's a different, they use a different model. So they have not been able to do that, because that would take an amount of, DOT doesn't collect that information or keep it in any one particular place, and the amount of work to do that to make it work in every community would be nearly
impossible. Yeah, I think that your graphing of that, your representation of that, has got so many different factors, so many variables, that it's not like housing. Housing becomes a little cleaner, straight line, cost
mm-hmm.
of housing, relative income, and that was making
right.
sense. What was happening in your transit graph then was looking kind of, you know, like there wasn't as much variation. You weren't seeing that nuance, but I think that there's so many factors in there that you have to kind of pull out 10 different graphs to really show the nuance of those factors.
That's exactly true. And you are also right, and this is actually becoming a fair housing issue. So the other problem is that a lot of affordable housing is near location efficiency, but it also has a tendency to be in high poverty areas.
Right.
And so there are a lot of fair housing advocates have said, wait a minute, you can't add this, because that's going to then push people into higher poverty areas. And if we want to disperse poverty, that's not going to work, which is part of the reason why when we did the studies, the housing analysis, and why I showed the picture of like the areas in Denver, you can say here are location efficient areas
mm-hmm.
with low poverty. Let's help people move into those communities where they still have access to transportation. It's still location efficient, but they're not being put in areas that are just supporting that. The part of the analysis, and the analysis will probably be posted on the HUD site fairly soon. They have one like under the Office of Sustainability Office of Sustainable Housing and Communities. OSHAC. They have a kind of a subpage in there for the housing and transportation. It'll also be on the portal. But it's a great example. What they did was they looked at it and they found some really interesting things. It said that the folks who were using vouchers, different things, were actually going to, you know, other communities, but they still needed to rely on transit in most cases. So they, you know, they did target places sometimes that were higher areas of
I'm working in that property. Exact community, voucher community, high poverty.
But there are ways that you can overlay your information in your own community to look for it there.
Right.
Okay.
Thanks. It sounds like a fairly complicated modeling procedure. So, you know, I would say it's just looking at all that, too, some kind of factors. Thanks for coming.
You're very
welcome.
Appreciate it. Happy to be here.